Hello.
Hello, America.
I am Laurie.
I'm Peter.
And I'm Hamilton.
And I talk loud. We are with Action Heroes LA, the subsidiary of Heroes Character Rental Service, doing another review for...
The Harder They Fall.
The Harder They Fall, a new movie that just came out. When it came out, in October or so, I forget. I don't know. Well, I found it on Netflix this week. And it's starring... Let me get my notes, and I dropped my pen.
Idris Elba,
yeah, that's...
Regina King.
Yeah, Zazie Beetz, Regina King, Jonathan Majors, LaKeith Stanfield, Delroy, Lindo, and Deon Cole, which is quite a cast.
Yeah. It's an all-star cast.
Yeah.
And written and directed by James Samuel. So this is a Western with... obviously an all-black cast, which is something different. Not too different, because you had what Mario Van Peebles did 30 years ago, probably. But anyway, it's the interesting about this Western, it is a fictional story, but it uses real figures from the American West, the real cowboys, the black cowboys
that you never hear about.
It uses their names. It doesn't really tell their true stories, but... It's really cool that they did that. Anybody want to go first? Hamilton, you usually do. You want to dip into this?
I think this film, I can't really say too many things critical or negative about it. It's got like an ensemble cast of everyone in the film is strong, and there's a lot of breakout performances. Like people I've seen before, but I had no idea they were as strong in their acting talent as they are, like Zazie Beetz. I can't think of the kid's name. I saw him in the film, what is that film? Earl, and the Dying Girl. Can't remember his name, sorry. But he's really good. Everyone's really good in this film. It's really enjoyable to watch. It's very entertaining. Jonathan Majors, I think at this point he's one of my favorite newer up and coming actors. Or I don't even know if I call him an up and coming at this point. I think he's pretty well solidified for his talent.
Making her review debut is Ginger. Right, Jen, you gonna join us this time? Hi, Big Jen. So yeah, this movie was very enjoyable. It was a lot of fun. I just was happy to see. It's not a trailblazing, not really doing anything different in terms of Western genres. It is a revenge. It is a you killed my parents revenge story, which is pretty typical from Westerns to Batman. But it was just so much fun to see these actors get to be in a Western.
Yeah.
You know, like, as kids, everybody is probably pretended to play cowboys and Indians and such. That it was a joy to watch them do this. And, Peter, you want to add anything while I take care of Ginge here?
Yeah. For me, you know, I'm an old guy, so I've seen a lot of... A lot of Westerns, or how we would call them, shit kickers. Okay, but anyway, so I've seen a whole lot of cowboys and Indians and, you know, Bat Masterson, this guy against that guy, everything else.
Yeah.
But I still have to say one thing about this movie. I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I think it's still the best Western I've ever seen. Now, I like the shooters. I really like the shooters. And of course, there's been a ton of other, you know, Westerns. But this one, it was hard Western, but it was also fun.
Right.
There was a lot of monologue, and usually in a lot of the old cowboy movies. They didn't really have a lot of that, but they had it here. And they did it kind of like a comic book kind of movie because of the colors that they used. But it was a really, really, really good movie.
Yeah, I think for a Western, it has to be fun. And that's what I really enjoyed about this film, is that it was fun. It was, you know, you can't watch this film and not, like I said, you can't watch this film and not enjoy it. Mm-hmm. I really liked Delroy Lindo as Bass Reeves. I've been a fan of Bass Reeves for about a minute, and I'm glad to see a film portray this character. I should mention, all of the characters in this film are based on people who actually existed. They put that in the first opening shot
of the film. Yeah, because they say, you know, they're gonna use real cowboys or real people's names that were actually cowboys or cowwomen or cowgirls back in the day.
Right.
But they did say, in which it is, this is a fictional movie.
Right. But I mean, like, you know, I think we were talking about it after we watched it, and one of the things that was interesting is because all of the actors are so well casted for this film, you could have had the Delroy Lindo play the villain, and you could have had Idris Elba play the Bass Reeves character, and they would have had the same kind of outcome. Mm-hmm. But it's fun because, you know, Idris Elba's a great villain. Regina King is a great villain in this film. LaKeith, Stanfield, everyone in this film brings something interesting to the overall result of the film itself.
Hi guys.
Welcome back, Laurie.
Sorry, she's spoiled. What can I say? Mm-hmm. But, so where you guys are, we've talked about. I enjoyed the movie a lot.
We mentioned Bass Reeves and
the characters that they portrayed, and I thought one of the cool things about this movie is them playing real characters and not telling their true stories. You go back and look up, oh, who is this? We had heard about Bass Reeves, but a lot of the other person, except for Pickett, Bill Pickett. And some of the other ones, I was like, oh, let me go look up to see who this was and who that was. So I really appreciate that about this film. This film was directed by James Samuels, who is also a musician and songwriter, producer, and he goes by the name, I think musically, as The Bullets. I've never heard of him. Mm. But he is doing music, but also doing short films, and I think this is his major film debut, and I mean, this guy looks like he's been doing films for a while.
He's very talented.
He is very talented. When I saw the previews for this movie, looked very sleek, looked very cool, and usually with something like that, you're kind of afraid it's not going to have a lot of substance. And, I mean, it isn't a deep movie, but it is a well-crafted movie. It's a lot better than I was expecting it to be. Yeah. I was expecting to see everything. It was either going to be like a music video most of the time and have that kind of fast pacing and cut. But it didn't. And he is like a director I'd like to see more stuff from.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the things that you were talking about earlier that I didn't think about it at the time, but you were dead on. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, when you do a movie or when an action movie or anything, a person goes to a certain point and then you think, well, this next thing is going to happen.
Right.
And it usually does. And even if you don't say it, your mind automatically goes there, and that person does it. Or, you know, here comes that build up and then nothing. Or here comes, okay, it's going to, you know, you're expecting something to happen in about 5 seconds and happens right now.
Okay. Well, I was talking about another movie, but I will, like, the gunfight at the end of this movie is really well done in terms of, it's just not bam, 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 you know, because what a lot of directors will do, a lot of filmmakers will do is just like more is better, but this one, he paces it a certain way.
Right.
You know, like I said, you don't know, he builds tension. He like waits. It's like where you would usually expect, or where other it's become so predictable and cliche where mm-hmm. you would expect certain things to happen.
Right.
He holds back. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. he stretches us out. He builds the moments and things like that.
Yeah.
So
right.
it was a really impressive fight, gunfight.
Okay, we gotta mention the soundtrack on this film.
Another thing, he did the soundtrack. He did the sound, which is another impressive thing. You're already directing and writing a movie. I can't imagine also like creating the score.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
as well as reggae music and as well as
the music,
Nigerian high life music, Fela Kuti music. In a Western, it just works really well. In this film.
It's the song choices they choose work really well. And one thing is I was afraid of, because this is produced by Sean Carter, who we all know as Jay-Z.
Mm-hmm.
And typically, another typical thing they usually do, obviously, it's going to be a Western with all black people. It's just going to be rap song after rap song after rap mm-hmm. song. Mm-hmm. And while there is some of that, there's just a variety of choices from across black music.
Right.
And music in general, which was really refreshing. And the music choices were spot on. It just worked really well with whatever scenes, in terms of the song choices, and also the score really worked. Another one that did not just your typical orchestral score.
Mm-hmm.
He made some different choices in terms of how he orchestrated his score. Which I really enjoyed. I wanted to mention how these people exist, like the white people are in their peripheral. You know, when you talk black people in America, it's either like through the eyes of white persons, their lives.
It wasn't so much that they were on the periphery. It was more like there was clearly a division, like there was a black town and there was a white town,
right?
You know, and you get a sense that that's kind of like what it was like.
But usually there's more story involving the whites, and either, I mean, this was about the black town and the black people, and and there is a sense that it's like we gotta build something for ourselves, outside, and we're not, you know, outside of that, but. Like I said, they were peripheral. They didn't really approach it because they're so, they do this to us and they do that to us. It's just like, we got to have our own, you know?
Right.
It wasn't focused on the,
See, that was the thing of seeing this, when there was black and white interaction, it wasn't, they hate, nobody hated because of somebody else's color.
Well, that's naturally implied. You know, like you understand that in terms of because what the story you're telling and what the people you're telling. And that's what's beautiful about it. They didn't have to go like, you know, they didn't have to hammer you.
Yes, they don't.
They didn't have to say that, you know.
Yes.
You know, it's America. It's
right.
Particularly, you know. And another thing was funny. There's only one scene. They have to go to the white town. And it's interesting. This movie has some nice rich color.
Is it Maysville?
They go to White Town, and it's completely white. I mean, everything is whitewashed. Every building is this whitewashed color.
Oh,
it's kind of hilarious.
But
to the point, they have one of the buildings has Ivory soap painted on it.
But you know what? What I really liked about it was presented in a comic book way.
It was kind of a comical way, and it wasn't about our suffering at the hands of these people. It's just like, nah, they over there. We know how they are.
Yeah.
we gotta do things for ourselves because we know how they are, and stuff. So let's get in and get out. We gotta deal with them this one time and get in and get out, and let's go back to our business among our own people.
Yeah.
And I really like that about the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I have a few criticisms I want to level against it.
Okay.
But I do think, I said it's not a very deep movie, although the ending, and I hate saying this because if you haven't seen it yet,
then I don't want you to be looking for it. Yeah.
But there is a plot development at the end.
Yeah. Rosie Perez is in this.
She should have been. anyway, there's a plot development at the end that, like I said, I just said this isn't a deep movie, but you can interpret this as kind of a, maybe where the movie gets a little deeper.
I don't know. I got up to here.
Yeah, I mean, it's not super deep, but you can interpret it as kind of a message movie. It's not a super
message
movie.
I didn't want it to be too deep.
Yeah, yeah. But I think you can, like I said, you can like understand like what that development could say in a larger context. Mm-hmm. It's an amazingly acted scene. It's like, I don't know, part of the plot, does it lead up to that, or is that such an out of the blue development for you? It wasn't.
I liked it.
It wasn't out of the blue, but
it was a nice surprise.
I wasn't expecting it, and I liked the twist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He said the word. He said the T word.
He said the T word.
No, I liked it a lot too. I wasn't expecting it, and it was. It was so, I think in a lot of movies it can come off as like, oh, come on, or cliched, or something. But it's so well acted, and that's the benefit of this movie. You have all these really great-ass actors in it, that it just really hits. It's the deepest moment. That and kind of Regina King gets a moment to tell her story, which is great. Mm-hmm. So, My beefs with it. Anybody have any beefs with this?
I have one beef.
I have one beef. I'm gonna bring up somebody else's beef that I came across just yesterday. My beef is with having the light skin love interest. That's so typical with all black movie, you know.
I didn't see it that way.
I think Zazie Beetz.
Her character was probably based on a real.
It was, but
character.
And no, she was not. Okay. Stage Coach Mary looked nothing like Zazie Beetz, and not that movies do that, but this was a large. The Stage Coach Mary was a really big. Dark-skinned black woman.
To see that kind of representation in all black cast.
As light-skinned girl, I like seeing light-skinned people.
I didn't really think much of that.
It's always the love interest that's such.
I thought she was great.
I mean, Coach Mary looked more like Regina King than
I thought Zazie
Regina
Beetz
King
was
and
great.
200 pounds.
I thought she.
Okay. And then you got Stagecoach Mary.
What about Rosie Perez jumped into the.
That was a problem.
This is something black films do. All black casts. Uh-huh. They tend to throw the light skin love interest in.
I mean, you
except
could say
Spike
that.
Lee is the one who really.
You could say the thing about rap videos always have light skin black women as the sexual objects or whatever. But I didn't really see it that way. I thought Zazie Beetz was great.
I thought she was great too. I wish they were thoughtful about that.
Who was the boy that had the other guys thinking, man, I sure like to.
Oh, she was great too.
Oh. She was a she?
Yes. You didn't know that was a woman that whole time?
I don't know who y'all are talking about. I'm sorry.
William Cathay?
Yeah, I forgot her.
So.
Name, okay.
So that's my another beef. This was brought up by an actor I kind of follow and I knew when I was a kid, Hawthorne Jeymes, who was Big Red in the Five Heartbeats. He posted something the other day on Facebook, and he talking about British actors taking American roles, and Jeymes is really kind of radical about stuff. But there's a kind of beef going on between.
They had a natural in there and they didn't have natural forks yet.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm sorry. You lost me, Peter.
I'm sure they had, they already had, this is probably, Madam C.J. Walker was about to have been
Oh, yeah,
cold.
Yeah,
Come
this
on.
Was
they
another,
had to be able to have, pick
this
out
is maybe
the
another
hair.
50 years before Madam C.J. Walker invented the hot comb.
But I'll get back
to the light skin. You see, I get shit because of this light skin, dark skin shit. Please put some beautiful dark skin sisters in the leads of these
movies. I want to say this, Laurie.
Anyway,
I didn't see it. I'm sorry. I don't mean to I like a film. I like a film with an all-black cast.
Are we still doing this?
I like an.
And she's a great actress. Yes, I like. I loved her in Atlanta and stuff.
I like a film like this with an all-black cast with different shades of, mm-hmm. of black represented, because that is what black
they
is.
They said Issa Rae in that role.
Just one shade. So I didn't really, I thought Zazie Beetz was great.
I thought she was great too, but just the kind of like, it's a sticking point. It's happened so often that I
gotta defend this film. This film, they tried to do a lot of things that were original. Like I said, the music, the choices in the music, they made an effort to do something different. I've seen other all-black westerns, and I thought this.
I bet they had a light-skinned love interest.
Maybe, I don't know.
Check it out. But, so you don't notice because you're just looking at, oh, she's pretty.
But I really didn't get that vibe.
Well, I tell you, that girl, what was her name? Regina King.
Regina King.
Yeah. Regina King's one of my favorite actors.
Everyone, like I said, everyone in this film is really strong.
Yeah.
You know, every performance is
very strong.
So I want to get back to the.
You're not gonna like her light eyes.
Who?
Regina King.
Oh my gosh, we've like railroaded this whole review at this point, talking about racial color politics.
She went to Westchester High School.
Well, she has beautiful eyes.
Yeah, she's St. Vernon's rival, though. Yeah, she's the enemy. She's supposed to be the enemy. Well, you didn't go to St. Bernard's, but I did. But anyway, yeah. I wanted to get back because
I went to Crenshaw. I didn't like Westchester either.
Okay. Well, there we go.
Out of this conversation.
But we love Regina King.
Yeah. I went to
but anyway.
School across town, so what can I say?
Yeah, I just want to bring up the British actors, and we have Idris Elba taking. There's a beef between actors, like the British actors taking on. Black American black roles, like
but
you had with the Martin Luther King.
You're good. That's unusual though, because there were a lot of
Let me finish with the beef, because this is coming from an American black actor who has to get roles, and is, you know, there's a lot of British actors coming here and being picked for these iconic American roles. And the problem is, there's a lot of these actors have been making commentaries about American blacks that have not, it's not been cool, you know, like they're not trying hard enough or something like that, or they need to do this or need to do that. And, you know, you got to understand, it's like American, being African American and being the inheritance of the psychology of slavery is different from being, you know, from another country and your parents got to immigrate to choice to immigrate somewhere and didn't quite have the same kind of, you know, trajectory to upon them. So I mean, I just wanted to bring that up, that there, so here we have another, and I'm not complaining about it because I love this movie, but when I saw after watching this and like, wow, I wonder, even seeing him, and it's like, oh dude, man. It's like me raving on about the light skin sister being on the
I think I should add
being
though,
a love
y'all,
interest cliche
I think,
and stuff
I think
so
it's
like
not fair to just make a statement about black actors from Britain. I mean, I think a lot of British actors are dominating in Hollywood because they play American characters so well. You know, I mean,
for a long time, American actors played American characters
they can do
how many
everything.
British? I mean, Jeymes, the director, is British. We have Idris Elba is British. I'd have to check to see who else is in this movie. Everybody else might be American.
But what about that guy that played Lawrence of Arabia? He played Lawrence of Arabia, and he had blue eyes.
We're not talking about white people. Because white people do that, that's their thing. You
know? But we have had some black actors who had played roles that were originally for white actors. So
rarely.
It's rare.
That's the point. So I'm just saying I know it wouldn't be so bad if the actors coming from England didn't like do a little shit talking about American actors, you know? Mm-hmm. So, and kind of like as the final scene, the climax of this movie illustrates, maybe we shouldn't be so judgmental about, you know, where a person's coming from and what choices they make and why they are doing things. You got to know what they're where they're coming from right. with this from both sides, and we need to pay more attention to that. So anyway, shall we wrap up?
Yes, let's wrap this up.
The harder they fall, letting you find some final words.
I think if this film had been released in theaters, I think it would have done really well, actually. It would have been interesting to see how it would have done.
I think there may be some places that might be on the big screen. I have to double check.
Right.
I don't think it was straight to Netflix, but right. Yeah.
Well, it was a good movie. Highly enjoyed it.
Yeah.
This movie was a lot of fun. It's on Netflix right now. It's The Harder They Fall. If you've seen it, or once you watch it, leave some comments in our comments. Tell us what you think in the comments. I do want to shout out, if I lost my note, I can't shout them out, the two guys who posted comments, and they're also movie reviewers. Oh yeah, here. Anthony A. Perez, who checked out our Dread review, and it's a movie he loves, so you might want to check out. It's kind of, he just recently reviewed it, so check out his review on his channel. Mm-hmm. But awesome. It seems like it's kind of a movie that's getting its due. A lot of people are coming out, I just watched this, it was great. How did I miss this movie? He also has this guy, Blacktastic Media, who guested on his review. That was awesome. Just the name Blacktastic Media is awesome. and also Mike from Did You See That, who did a review of Respect. He commented on a Respect review, and I've checked out his. So, you know, check out these guys. If you review movies on YouTube, even if you don't, leave a comment, leave a link to your review so I can check it out, or we can check it out. And we out like Idris Elba breaking out, getting broken out of a train. I don't
that
know.
Was great.
I don't know if it was, but.
I like those, Larry, when you come up with the.
We out, y'all. Good night.
We out.